They are stupid.
Hello, art family. And thank you so much to the new subscribers and the kindness and support on Patreon. For this video, I wanted to do a bonus full-length demonstration, just like the videos I do once a month on Patreon. It's a watercolor demonstration of the old stone mill in the New York Botanical Gardens. I'm working on 12 by 16 cold press 140-pound arches watercolor block. I start out with a simple drawing, trying to focus on the major shapes and finding where the windows are. I recommend keeping one of those clear rulers on you, or right angles, because they're handy for getting straight lines, but also if you hold them up in the air in front of you at a tilt, they create a sort of slightly darker line. You can line up with roof lines and streets and street signs and things like that to find your perspective. If you struggle with perspective, it's a really handy tool, or if you're trying to do perspective at a different size. Like, I usually work very small, so working 12 by 16, it's easier for me to swing those long straight lines just using the square held up against the top with my fingers. I start out by pre-wetting the whole page, basically, avoiding some areas for clouds to shine through, and then I'm going to pre-mix a kind of pool of gray. It was gray at the time. In fact, I actually got rained on. It started raining on me here in a minute, and some of the staff from the Botanical Gardens were kind enough to run over and bring me an umbrella. But because it's a kind of cloudy day, I'm going to focus on creating a sort of grayscape in the sky, using ultramarine and burnt sienna as my gray, and I'm going to shift very subtly between the two, and I'm using a lot of water because I really want the sky to recess and be, you know, almost not even noticeable at all, just a very subtle hint of a sky. But I'm going to use that mixture of ultramarine and burnt sienna gray towards the top, and then I'm going to shift it to a yellow ochre on the bottom, just to pick up some of that warmth where the light is getting trapped in the clouds, or where light is bouncing off, because light changes every 20 minutes. So this scene was very rainy. In fact, it was raining on me at certain points in the sketch, but also every now and then it would be very bright and sunny. So I went ahead and decided to stick to the battle plan here and go with a kind of diffuse light on the image, and go with this sky that shifts from the sort of cooler gray on the top with some sky holes for the clouds sort of mixed in here and there, and then a warmer bottom of the sky. I'm working my way down the image, and my main goal, I'm going to shift the colors as I go from burnt sienna to ultramarine, some raw sienna here and there. I'm trying to keep the distance cooler, so I'll probably put in some cooler colors in there. Cerulean blue, or maybe cobalt blue, depending on the area, or even some lavender, because I like that kind of subtle lavender color. But I'm shifting colors as I move around the image, but my main goal is to just give some color notes, but to also get rid of the white as much as possible, except for just the places where I want it. The brush I'm using is the Escoda Ultimo, which I'm a huge fan of, and I use it for most of this entire painting. They're an artificial squirrel, like a synthetic version of a squirrel brush, and this is a size 18, which I believe is the biggest that they make. But they hold so much water. They're really excellent brushes, especially for initial washes or just trying to fill whole areas. If you need to fill, you know, wash across the whole page for stuff, they're really, really handy to have. I find if I'm trying to do this type of painting, especially one at this size, which I very rarely work this size, but if you're working larger especially, they're very handy, because every time I've tried to use like Prado or one of the other Perla or the other large sizes to fill a big area, I find I get a lot of blooms and I have trouble having enough water to really fill an area without having to keep reloading, and then that messes up the the mixture. But with this brush, you can kind of keep going and going, and all the mixtures tend to hold together better, in at least in my experience. Once I have the initial wash all the way down the page, I just leave it for a little while to dry. Just take a break, try to let it all dry. Everything dries much lighter than you think it's going to, but I try to just let it sit and dry for a little while and then come back to it in a minute. Because it was raining this day, all the drying time took a little bit longer than it normally would if you're painting in the sunlight. If you're painting on a really sunny day, a lot of times it feels like you're sort of painting in an oven. Like, it feels like the paint's cooking as you put it down, which can be really challenging. The humid air, I feel like, actually kind of helped me work much bigger than I usually do, because I didn't feel like I was having to actively fight against the paint drying so fast. What I'm trying to do now is sort of set the stage or set the chess pieces up for my strategy. If you look at the image, you can see that the trim around the windows was a light gray, and the actual windows were fairly dark. And to do the darker windows, I'm going to keep them warm. So it's going to either be burnt sienna and ultramarine, or maybe burnt umber and ultramarine, but I'm going to pitch it towards the warmer side. But before I do that, I kind of want to set the stage for that by painting in, because that's the windows are going to be darker, I can get away with sort of just doing the whole frame area in a lighter gray here, using, I believe, ultramarine and burnt sienna. I might have used some lavender just to give it some kind of coolness to it, but I'm putting in the whole frame first, because that's my lightest area on the building. Right now I'm just sort of popping around these areas that I know are going to be sort of gray or lavenderish, and then are kind of lighter, because I can come back in with the darker stuff around and on top, and it won't mess those up. So I'm just sort of setting the stage now for later steps that will go, I'll either do something directly into it, like the windows, or like the brick of the building, where I can sort of paint around those and sharpen up the shapes as I go down. So now I'm painting in the stones on the wall. So I'm going to be using slightly less water than I did with the gray mixture, but I'm using burnt sienna and ultramarine to get a kind of gray, and then I'm going to pitch that towards raw sienna. So I'm going to add some raw sienna into it just to give it the kind of stone look, but I'm not going to just do that and then sort of coat it evenly. One thing I'm trying to do is give it that sense of texture and stone look by every couple times I dab the brush against the page, I go back and pull from a mixture with a little bit more ultramarine, or a little bit more burnt sienna, or a little bit more raw sienna, or a little direct raw sienna in some areas. and I'm just sort of slowly working my way down, negative painting in those windows, which is to say I'm painting the area around the window just to sharpen up the shape of those windows. And I'm just going to work my way down, shifting every here and there so that the colors will blend together, but not perfectly. There will be a kind of imperfect blend of those colors and a kind of uneven mixture and tone against the stone. As I get lower on the building, I add some very light green to it as well. I think I use some cadmium yellow with a little bit of ultramarine blue. And there's still a fair amount of water in this, so when I do that and I put those areas in towards the bottom, that's again setting that stage so that when I come back later to do the trees, you'll have some lighter pops of green within that, some stronger yellow pops of green, so that when I sort of chisel out the area later with darker stone, you'll have these little reveals of a lighter green. As I work my way down, I want the bottom of the stone mill to just sort of get lost within the greenery and in the bushes. I can work in some darker tones later to sort of show where it's revealing itself. A lot of this area kind of gets cut off by a tree that was shooting up through that part, so I'm not really worried about that tree at all because it's a much darker value than the rest of it. If you close your eye and squint at the image, you can see the sort of read of values, which is my key concern here. So I have this in my mind broken down into three major areas that I'm focused on, and I'm trying to do my best to keep them consolidated as best as possible into a background and a middle ground and a foreground. And the choices I make with color, saturation specifically, and value, the intensity of the choices I make, are all going to go towards trying to feed those ideas. So if it's something I want to be in the background or I want it to recess, I'm going to make color choices and saturation choices that will help to make that a stronger idea. Because my goal overall is concision of shape, in a sense concision of marks. With this one, I was really trying to explore using texture as a means of putting in so much information that there's too much information to care about. So the areas that I wanted to be really important, I tried to keep relatively simple but have sharper value choices and sharper saturation, a sharper intensity of edges. And then around it, I wanted there to be a sort of blur of too much information so that it kind of makes it recess in terms of value of interest. So it sort of, you know, falls away a little bit from importance. Because the old stone mill is in the middle ground, I'm going to try to treat everything behind it with less sharpness of edges, with less saturation, so the colors will be slightly duller, slightly cooler, in the hopes that they'll sort of push back in the distance. And then I'm going to make the colors on it more saturated, more intense. I'm going to use much sharper edges, and of course it's architecture, so that's going to sort of be a given that the edges are going to be relatively crisp on the building itself, which will help draw focus to that, the object of interest. But in the foreground, I'm going to increase the saturation even more to try to sell that depth, because I'd like to have a kind of telescoping effect, if I can, just to draw the viewer into the picture, to make them feel like they're standing there on this bridge. I'm trying to set the stage in the water. There's a pretty strong reflection of the green, that this very lush, vibrant green in the trees above it. But before I worry about any of that, I'm using a fair amount of water here, so this is all going to dry much lighter once it actually dries. But I'm coming in with this really strong green now that's very watered down, so that later, which again, if you close one eye and squint at the image, you can see that the trees are much darker. There's some pops of darker value here and there, and then the little stream that runs by the stone mill is also a very dark value. So I'm trying to group that value with the trees as a sort of darker value. So I can come in now with some lighter colors just to sort of spice and flavor the darker value later on, so that when I come in with a darker value, it will have little kind of highlights and pops of this light green that's picking up this reflection of the vibrant trees above it. I'm using some lavender and maybe some cobalt blue and a whole lot of water to try to again set the stage for a cooler area behind the architecture. Now that that area has dried, I'm coming back and switching to a perla, the largest size available of that. And I really like perlas because they're a synthetic brush. They hold a whole lot of water, but the end still maintains a fairly sharp point. So you can get away with doing a lot of really big areas, fill big areas, but you can still do some nice fine detail where you need to, or work your way around certain things if you need to. But I'm working my way with the side of the brush and slightly less water so that it's fairly dry. I can sort of work in a bit of a texture just by dragging the side of the brush along the bricks, just to get these little pockets, these tiny pockets of a very, very slightly darker, sort of warmer value notes that make it look like stone instead of just a flat surface. So I'm just sort of dancing around with that, just trying to build in some texture to add some interest to it and to sell the fact that it's stone. I'm coming in with some warmer tones, I believe probably raw sienna and again, probably from that gray burnt sienna and ultramarine, and some raw sienna to kind of warm it up. I'm trying to get those underplanes. All of the planes that are facing downward, I'm going to give just the sort of subtle, warm and darker note. So before I get too carried away with the details, I'm going to switch back to my ultimo brush, the large ultimo brush, and I'm going to mix up a couple big pools of color to wash in the big area of all those trees in the background. To do that, I'm using cobalt blue and light red to get a kind of gray, sort of purpley gray, and then I'm using raw sienna and yellow ochre, maybe some ultramarine here and there, lavender towards the bottom, and I'm just going to I pre-wet some of the area towards the top so that you get some hardness, some softness here and there, and I'm going to try to leave some areas for sky holes where I can, although I don't focus too much on that as much as I do just trying to get, you know, these really big shapes. And so I don't focus on the exact trees that are there. I don't count them or what specific ones they are. I close an eye and I squint, and I try to get a general idea of the shape. And I try to look for where it meets the roof. You know, is it above the roof or below the roof? Does it, you know, touch the chimney or, you know, a certain part of the architecture that I can kind of build from there? And then I'm allowing the water to sort of run out on the brush so that when I come back through on the side of the brush, I can roughen areas like this so you get some kind of organic looking sky holes here and there. My goal here is to separate the distinction of the background from the sky, which the sky, I don't have any interest in this particular sketch in, so I'm just sort of, you know, letting that go. But this I want to make sure is my distinct background, so I'm making these color choices like I do the other strokes, where I'm coming back to the palette and using a different pool every couple strokes so that you're getting a very uneven kind of splotchy display of different colors. The only specific choices I'm making are trying to have some warmer areas where it looks like light is getting into the leaves, particularly towards the top, just to give the sense of forms of trees instead of just like one chunk of color. And then I'm also cooling it down towards the bottom. There will probably be a darker value running through there, but I still want to set the tone for that. I like using a cooler color like lavender or cobalt blue and kind of keep it washy, and also use a very thirsty brush to draw back some of that towards the bottom as well. I do that a lot with mountains, where two mountains meet. I believe I learned it from David Bellamy in one of his films he showed doing it, or it might have been James Fletcher Watson, who described trying to capture this sort of mist between objects. You can separate things, and I like to do that with trees and forests, to just use a thirsty brush to draw back some of the color towards the bottom, so you get this sort of, there's like a whimsy to it, there's like a sense of you know, mist or mystery to it, and I really like that, so I try to enhance that in all the pictures I do. So as we curve around the stream and get into the middle ground area, I'm going to increase the saturation so you can see the trees are getting slightly more green. I believe I might have used some viridian in there too to just get some kind of quick cool green, but the main thing that you might notice is that the colors are getting more saturated, and you can kind of see that now as I'm putting it down in this example. So you can see back as we move down the stream and away from the viewer, things get slightly cooler and they also get more watered down, so the saturation, the intensity of the color is not as vibrant. We're starting to lose some of that vibrance and saturation. And as we increase that saturation and increase those choices that we make with value, it sort of draws an area into the middle. So I'm trying to sort of create a distinction now, even though this is all wet and it's blending together, which is what I want, because I'm trying to treat this all as one big shape and not worry about any of the trees or, you know, whether the leaves are pointing in any specific direction, or really, I don't even care that there are leaves. I'm closing an eye and squinting, and I'm seeing this huge rectangle moving behind the building, and it's sort of moving in perspective. And so we're coming out and down this stream towards the bridge I'm standing on, and I'm trying to just increase that saturation so that you can feel that movement of the stream and of the space too, so it just adds to the sort of spatial awareness. And here I'm finding some use for a membership card to an art store in my neighborhood that is closing. So now that I don't need this membership card, I can use it for texturing paintings. So I'm trying to pick up areas where you get light limbs. Sometimes with trees, you'll get a variation of dark and light limbs, or trunks, you'll get dark and light trunks. And so I'm trying to add to the sort of craziness of that area, the textural noise of that area, by just adding some suggestions. So I I'm not really like counting trees or limbs or trunks or whatever. I know that there are some there and they're lighter. I can see that when I close an eye and squint. I understand that some are there. It's doubtful someone's going to hold this painting up on this bridge and count, so no one really cares how many trees are there. So I'm just giving a suggestion of these branches and trunks, just to sort of give a sense of the there being there. It adds to the kind of spatial awareness of the scene. Oh, hello. So now that we have that big shape in, I'm gonna try to let that whole area dry, and while that area is drying, I'm gonna focus in on these little windows and details. Now that I have the stone sort of put in and the texture put in, I still have my little light gray pockets that I sort of preset in the beginning of the sketch. So now I'm gonna go directly into those and put in the windows. And I'm also not particularly counting the window panes in particular. I'm trying to keep that fairly, just the sort of suggestion of windows. I'm not gonna just, you know, scrub them in so it's totally random. There's a touch of specificity to the windows, the shapes at least. I'm trying to at least ballpark the specifics. Sometimes it's nice to keep one open just to add some variation to the windows. I don't know if I did that in this one because they seem pretty fixed, but if you're doing architecture, sometimes it's nice to just have a little bit of a variation within the windows. So now I'm trying to get in some of that wild variation in texture within the forest. And I'm going to do that by using the side of the brush. This is a Prado, the biggest size they have. I think it's an 18. But I'm using it on its side. It's a lot of water in this because I'm still trying to keep it fairly light. And I'm using the side of the brush to just knock in these bits of textures. I'd like to get a little bit of texture, and I'd also like to get some random splatter pattern. So I'm gonna load up some water and some color and just knock the side of the brush just to get some splatter, just to get some of those tiny pockets. Again, trying to keep it pretty ambiguous. In some of these areas, I pre-wet the trees again just to so that when I came back with the Prado to start knocking in some of the darker values of some of the tree trunks, I wanted them to just get lost in the kind of mist and the kind of forest behind the stone mill. So I pre-wet some random areas. So when I put in these tree trunks, as I get going, some of the areas are going to be slightly darker, slightly harder, but then it's going to touch some of these areas where they start to dissolve and it just falls apart. So the end result, you get this kind of lost and found tree trunks in the distance. It'll give you the sense, not just the kind of the lost and found mistiness of that, but also that, you know, tree, chunks of tree are sort of overlapping. So my tree trunks are kind of coming and going as they work their way up through the chunks of leaves. When you're doing splattery sort of texture like this, It's usually a good idea to have a separate sort of sheet of paper or some kind of something to cover up some areas you don't necessarily want it, because it can really get away from you. Not just in the fact that it can splatter all over the stuff you don't want it to splatter on, but it can also just sort of get away from you in the sense that, you know, at least in my opinion, some watercolor paintings have like way too much splatter, where people get really carried away with it. So I think it's good to try to hold back that kind of thing, and don't get too carried away with the whimsy of splattering paint on it. It's good, like everything, in moderation, I think. So I'm starting to work my way down now into the brush and bush of this closer to the foreground area. And you might take note that I'm using less water now, that my colors are starting to get more saturated and stronger, and my edge decisions are also going to get a little bit sharper. But I'm working my way down using the side of the brush, and in some areas less water, or just allowing the brush to run out of water, and then using the side of the brush to rough in some texture, just to try to achieve some of that randomness that you get in nature, to add a kind of organic element to it. And again, like I said earlier in the video, I'm trying to also just get a kind of scattershot of information. A great example of that would be the Impressionists. Of course, like Monet, you know, some of the great Sicily impressionists who would use an overdose of information to take away from the importance of an area. So you get these sort of daubs and dashes of color, but they're a similar value. So if you close an eye and squint, tonally, they read as a kind of illusion of value. You get this sense of depth and value, but when you're looking at the painting itself, you're just getting kind of attacked with color. There's all this information coming at you, and it's kind of like looking at a book that's too dense, where you just go, oh, this is too much, I can't read all this, like, what's the point, you know? And so I'm trying to, of course, I will never ever be at a level where I replicate anything near what they were able to do then, but I'm trying to take the ball of that idea and run with this sort of scattershot of information to detract from the object of interest and to, you know, in point, draw focus to the object of interest in a sketch or in a painting, you know. And that could be anything. It could be a coffee cup, it could be a salt shaker or a person, or in this case, an old beautiful stone building. I'm trying to anchor this area now by adding in some darker value, and it's still fairly wet, so it's all kind of melting together. But I'm using, you know, more intensity value to sort of draw this closer to the viewer. But my main focus still, even though I'm keeping it loose and I'm keeping it scratchy and intentionally allowing it to fall apart, but my main focus is still to close an eye and squint and focus on the most simple thing, pattern of shapes that I'm seeing. So I'm looking at a dark area, but I'm not looking at whether or not it's a particular part of a bush or what it's necessarily an extension of. I'm just focusing on the fact that there's a circle of darkness here, which is connected to this kind of dark rectangle that stretches out over here, and I'm just focusing on the shape. While this area is wet, this is kind of a an idea I picked up from Master James Fletcher Watson, who's, you know, I think he's probably my all-time favorite hero in watercolor. But he'll use a pen knife or like a pocket knife, and he'll come back in a large wet area, like if he's doing a field closer to the foreground, he'll use the point in the side of his knife to kind of scrape in some texture. So I'm using this, now useless art membership card to try to cut back in some of the limbs, some of that randomness of the limbs and the lighter notes within the sort of bushes. So I have my big broad dark shape, and then I'm trying to just kind of cut back in some highlights in places where the light's picking it up, or on this tree it happens to have lighter branches. Come to think of it, another really great artist to look up I think he actually uses a credit card for mostly with oil that I've seen. I don't know if I'm sure he probably uses it with watercolor too, because he's a genius in both mediums. But there's an Australian painter named Herman Pekel, and he's incredible. So you should definitely check him out and look at some of his paintings. He works really large, and it's all very textural and loose, but very concise and simple and to the point, and in that regard, extremely powerful paintings. So he's a genius. You should check him out if you haven't already. So while this area is still slightly wet, I'm going to come back in with some lavender, or maybe some cobalt blue, and just splatter into this area so that I don't really want hard splatter on this area, but because it's wet, it'll dissolve. And I'm using that lavender and cobalt blue so that you get, even though it's a sort of darker green area, you get these little sort of just little touches of light blues and kind of lavenders, and it is a botanical garden, so I'm trying to get the sense that there are some flowers down there, even though it was a pretty rainy day. So I didn't, like, the colors to me weren't as strong as the sort of lush overgrowth of trees that were really vibrant, but there were little patches of pinks and lavenders and purples and other colors. So I tried to get some of that suggested in the painting, but I wasn't as interested in that at this stage as I was trying to make the stone mill as important as possible. So I didn't want to take away from it by getting really into trying to, like, making a big, you know, flourish of a bunch of color. But I did want to have some suggestion of those notes kind of playing in the background, if that makes sense. So I'm trying to build up this sort of foreground, if you think of it that way, mainly to delineate the difference between the middle area where the stone mill is and then the background, which is even lighter and cooler as it goes back. So as I said earlier, I'm going to increase the saturation now. The color, the greens are now getting brighter and more vibrant. And to use that, to do that, I'm using mostly yellow ochre strongly. Occasionally I'll use a touch of cadmium yellow light. Cadmium yellow light is sort of difficult to kind of keep reined in. One thing I'm doing here too, you might notice, particularly there, is I have two pools. So I typically, as I've said, I have ultramarine and burnt sienna, so I'm doing a big green area, so I have a big green puddle, and I also have a big red puddle. So when I'm putting in the greens, I'm also putting in the reds at the same time. So they sort of compete with one another and then meld together into a sort of visual gray-brown at a certain tone. But my goal is to have this green and then a sort of matched tonal red that sort of dances alongside it, if that makes sense. When I'm painting trees or areas that are sort of like forests and have a lot of greens, I try to keep most green fairly contextual. It's a lot of either strong yellow ochre or sort of strong blues or some variation of a mixture there within that sort of is pitched towards brown, but I try to stay away from green because I have a terrible time keeping it controlled and reined in and not sort of ridiculous looking. That's what I was saying about cadmium yellow light, is I kind of struggle to keep it from, it comes in so strong, and I feel like whenever I use cadmium yellow light in within greens and trees, even if I'm just trying to get the sort of big areas where the light is hitting the tree, it just gets this sort of like, it looks like a kind of like a Pixar movie, like, or like a fantasy. Like it just doesn't look real. I have a terrible time pulling off a decent grade color with cadmium yellow light. It hits so hard, it's hard to control. So I try to stay away from that except for particular areas. But so for the most part, I keep the greens, some variation of yellow ochre and ultramarine or cobalt blue, or raw sienna and cobalt blue. I'm trying to get in some of the value notes. There is a deck that was shooting off this thing, and as the day went on, it was filling up with white chairs because they were getting ready for a kind of wedding. So I ignored all that because I didn't know how long it was going to be there, and it wasn't really of interest to me because I kind of liked the, when I first saw it when I was walking across this bridge, I liked the, it kind of looked to me like an old English painting. Like if you look at, you know, the old greats like Cotman and Constable, but these, or Turner even, you know, old like English landscape paintings. That really drew me to this particular building. So that was what jumped out at me at first. So within that, I was like, oh, I kind of wanted to keep it as close to that kind of idea as possible, even though it doesn't look anything like what those guys did. I mean, those guys are remarkable, but, I did want to keep within that kind of, look, the old sort of English landscapes from the 1700s and 1800s. So now, using a darker value, I'm going to start putting in my trees, which I've just left out until this point. I'm going to kind of go back and forth between using the plastic card and the brush held far back on the brush so that I can get a kind of organic. The main idea with trees, which is sort of obvious, is that they get thinner as they go. So, you know, you've got the base, and then as it goes up, it gets slightly thinner, and then the branches, and as they go out, they get slightly thinner, which seems kind of redundant to say, but that's just sort of what I keep in mind when I'm doing a branches or a tree. I just sort of keep that generally in mind, and then I try to hold the brush way back so that I allow myself to sort of let go of some of that control. That was something I learned from the painter Thomas Schaller. I saw him do that. And I really like that sort of lack of control you get, this sort of intentional letting go of control for something that's you know, organic and doesn't have that sort of sense of controlled structure. So if you hold the brush really far back, it kind of lets things sort of drift and wander, and, you know, you can't get a very straight line. So if you get these sort of jagged lines, and then the goal is just to sort of soften as you go so they get lighter towards the outside is the goal. putting in this darker tree that sort of breaks up the stone mill and then the bushes behind it. So I'm trying to move around some lighter areas to give the sense that there's an overlap there of some of the brush and branches and leaves and things, and also to try to connect it to those lighter dashes that I put in that are its branches, basically. But I'm trying to keep it sort of textural and also trying to take note of how the darker value of these trees is now going to set a new tone for darkness in this painting, which sounds kind of ominous, but I don't mean it that way. I just mean that when you apply value, you change the structure of the value in an image. So now that these trees have set a tone for this sort of this level of dark, the areas I want to be darker, I now have to go even darker with. And so you're kind of constantly playing that chess game. And with watercolor, it takes a bit of strategy to focus in on making it work, because you kind of have to, as you get darker, you can't really go back that well. I mean, you can certainly scrub areas out or use gouache if you want, but it's not like gouache or oil in my other videos where we talk about just being able to sort of go right back over top of an area if you need to. So here we are as we move around this stream. Again, we're increasing the saturation of this color, and I'm using the side of the brush to get a kind of randomness to the texture and the sense of leaves without actually trying to paint any of the leaves, and to leave some sky holes to show that sort of block shape of the cooler, less saturated trees in the background, so that you... Now we're trying to... I'm trying to break that into its separate area, so that area is now the background and this area distinctly is the foreground, so that we're sort of dividing them up and trying to simplify the idea. So now I'm ready to start putting in the water. And my strategy is I've kind of got my pieces all set up in play. I've got my wash of the green to try to get that sense of the reflection that's coming down. And I've also got my cool areas and places that I'm trying to get to that sort of match the sky a little better. And now I'm just taking this darker value and I'm just gonna work my way down. I believe this is a mixture of raw sienna and Payne's gray to get this darker value. And as always, I sort of dance between the two in one sort of single puddle. Every time I go back for color, I alternate between raw sienna and Payne's gray. So I'm trying to wash in this area, but keep it very sort of loose and textural, because I want there to be a brokenness to the shape, because I'd like to try to pick up where it's rippling and it's getting the highlights from the sky or highlights from the reflection of the trees. So I'm trying to keep it loose and use the side of the brush and scrape across just to sort of intentionally let go of some of that control. And this can get away from you very quick as well, but I'm trying to just leave little pockets and little openings just to give the sense of the water and of movement. I tried to go a little bit lighter here with some raw sienna to try to pick up the distinction between the sort of stony shore here and the water, but as you can kind of see, it got away from me right away, and it's too dark, so you kind of can't really tell the difference between the shore and the water itself. So my choice is to either try to go darker with the water, or I can try to bring back some of that stone. So I'm going to take a paper towel and just sort of try to pull back some of that color and lighten this area, and then I can bring some darker value into it to give a sense of shadow or overlap to the shore, so that you get the feeling that there's a delineation here between the shore and the water. I'm trying to break up the pattern here, and I'm going to also get my paper towel out to try to bring back some of the limbs that are moving over the water. I was trying to keep it sort of broken as I moved by, so you'd still get the sense that there were tree branches there above the water, but I feel like it sort of also got away from me. It's kind of getting lost here. It's not quite as clear as I want it to be, so I'm coming back and bringing that some of that back out. Thank you. I'm continuing to use the side of the brush here to try to get some of the foliage in the tops of that tree. Again, to sort of delineate and separate the middle ground area and the foreground area from the background area. Just so there's a very specific side-by-side example of here's a more saturated, intense green and yellow ochre up against that cooler tree shape, so that you get the sense that those trees are further back in the distance. And these trees that I'm working on now are closer. I'm mainly working on just adding some definition here and there, some textural variation to some of the shrubs and green areas. And I'm also really going to intensify the green here and bring some strong saturation, just to make sure that you're getting the distinct difference between these foreground trees that are highly saturated, and then the middle ground, and then the background. So there's a specific division, so that it's very simple, but it immediately gives you the sense of telescoping, that when you're looking at it, you're looking at the image, you're looking at a kind of, you're looking out of a window, so to speak. You sort of get the sense of space, and in my hope at least, that it really takes the person there to that moment, where you get the same feeling I did, where you're standing on that bridge and looking at this beautiful building. In this case. The last thing I'm going to do is come back in with some white gouache. Some of these areas I'm going to try to keep fairly random, given that I'm just trying to bring back some branches, and in this case some of these white flowers that were coming through, so you had this kind of strong white area. So I'm just bringing in some gouache straight out of the tube and painting directly on top of the picture with that. Well, that's going to be it for this demonstration. I hope you found it useful or helpful in some way. Of course, I'm always here to talk shop on here or on Patreon. And I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.